I'm Clara Tran. Asia-Pacific countries have agreed to cooperate on the extradition of corrupt officials and establish an anti-corruption transparency network. APEC members say it would be led by China, but also pushed forward by the United States. The agreement comes as Chinese President Xi Jinping seeks to widen his far-reaching graft campaign to catch suspects who have fled abroad. U.S. Secretary of State John Kerry says it's an important step in the right direction.
We think it's very constructive, and we have hopes that it can lead to a greater definition and to a reduction further of any conflict or tension in the region.
Australia's Foreign Minister Julie Bishop is in Beijing for the APEC meeting, along with Trade Minister Andrew Robb. Prime Minister Tony Abbott is expected to join them tonight. Indian police believe a 75-year-old Australian woman was murdered in the country's south by three men who stole her money and some jewellery. Police say the men have been charged with murder, as South Asia correspondent Stephanie March reports.
75-year-old Tony M. Ludgate was a devotee of the popular Indian guru Sai Baba. She arrived in India in July to visit his ashram in Andhra Pradesh and went missing in August. Police say she was murdered by the watchman at the apartment she was staying in and his two friends. Police Inspector B. Venugopal told the ABC he believes the guard stole some money, a necklace, a pair of earrings and two rings from Ms. Ludgate before murdering her and burying her body in a field. Her body was exhumed by police on Saturday and cremated at a nearby river in a traditional ceremony. Stephanie March, ABC News, New Delhi.
An Australian aid agency is urging G20 leaders to do more about fighting the Ebola epidemic in West Africa. An online petition by Save the Children is asking world leaders to discuss measures to assist Ebola-affected nations at this week's summit in Brisbane. Nearly 5,000 people have been killed by the virus, most of them in Liberia. Save the Children's CEO Paul Ronald says the global economy could suffer as a result of the leaders' decisions.
Without further investment from the world's wealthiest countries, and that's what Australia and others represent, we're going to continue to see this type of outbreak continue to ravage the world's poor countries and to do damage not just to their economies, but to the world's economies.
The US citizens Kenneth Bay and Matthew Todd Miller have been freed from detention by the North Korean government. The Office of the Director of National Intelligence says they're returning to the United States. 2 years ago, Mr. Bay, a missionary, was sentenced to 15 years of hard labour for crimes against the state. Mr. Miller had been in custody since April this year and sentenced to 6 years of hard labour. Sri Lanka has fiercely rejected an accusation by the UN human rights chief that it's sabotaging a war crimes investigation in the country's civil war. The BBC's Sanjay Dasgupta has more.
Sri Lanka's angry rejection of the UN official's comments that have come as a surprise. Last March, the UN Human Rights Council had ordered an international investigation into allegations that up to 40,000 ethnic Tamil civilians were killed in the final months of Sri Lanka's bitter and protracted civil war, which ended in 2009. The Sri Lankan government steadfastly denies that civilians were killed in such large numbers and has refused point blank to cooperate. It says its own division of inquiry can do the job.
The Indian Army has said it made a mistake earlier this week in shooting dead two teenagers in the disputed part of Kashmir it controls. Correspondents say it's a rare public admission of fault by a senior army officer over civilian deaths in the region. The teenager died when soldiers fired at a car on the outskirts of Srinagar. The army commander says they've received information about terrorists travelling in a car, but there's clearly been a case of mistaken identity. Australia's Governor-General Peter Cosgrove will today dedicate two memorials on Purpose Island to remember those involved in Australia's first major naval victory. It's 100 years since MHAS Sydney battled with the German cruiser, the Emden. Governor-General Peter Cosgrove will officially open a commemorative gazebo on Election Island, which will feature an account of the battle along with lists of the crews of both warships. On West Island, a service will dedicate a friendship mask, which will also honour both crews. Descendants of the crews will be attending. You're listening to Radio Australia. The Dutch foreign minister says the remains of the last victims of the Malaysia Airlines flight MH17 may never be recovered. The plane was down 4 months ago in rebel-held eastern Ukraine, killing everyone on board, including 38 Australian citizens and residents. Bert Kundas has washed this in the Ukrainian city of Kharkiv, as coffins carrying the remains of another 5 victims were flown to the Netherlands. He says 9 victims are yet to be identified. The clashes between pro-Russian rebels and Ukrainian forces make it difficult to access the crash site.
We cannot say at this moment in any certain way, because we know the forensic work, the complex work at the moment, and even if we can recover also those last 9. But we will do everything we can in cooperation with the authorities here to make it happen.
The former Soviet leader Mikhail Gorbachev has warned that the world is on the brink of another Cold War. Europe correspondent Barbara Miller.
Mikhail Gorbachev is in Berlin to mark the 25th anniversary of the fall of the wall, an event which might not have happened if it hadn't been for the reforms he introduced in the then Soviet Union. Mr. Gorbachev is using the occasion to issue a series of statements urging Russia and Europe to settle their differences, saying they're on the brink of another Cold War and that internal conflict is damaging Europe's standing. As the day of commemoration begins, the German Chancellor Angela Merkel and East German has described it as a miracle that the wall fell in 1989 without bloodshed. She said it was a night she would never forget. Barbara Miller, News Berlin. As Russian-Ukraine trade accusations about the latest alleged ceasefire violation, both countries are bracing for further declines in their respective currencies. Norman Hemant reports from Moscow.
The Kremlin has flatly denied Ukrainian claims that more than 30 tanks and artillery have crossed into eastern Ukraine from Russia in recent days. Amidst signs the ceasefire is fraying, both the Russian and Ukrainian currencies are taking a beating. Ukraine's hryvnia lost more than 11% by the end of the week, and in Russia, the ruble is also plunging. The currency is approaching the symbolically important benchmark of 50 rubles to the U.S. dollar. Some economists say that could set off panic selling of the ruble, similar to its collapse in the late 1990s. Norbert Hermont, ABC News, Moscow.
Car bombs have killed at least 33 people in the Iraqi capital Baghdad and the city of Ramada to the west. The 6 car bombs, which hit 5 different areas, also wounded more than 100 people. There was no immediate claim of responsibility for the bombing. Baghdad was hit by near daily bombings and shootings, some of which have been claimed by the Islamic State jihadist group. And in rugby union, the Wallabies have recorded their 10th consecutive victory against Wales after coming from behind to win 33-28 in Cardiff this morning. In front of more than 55,000 fans, the Welsh hit the front in the 64th minute after being awarded a penalty try. But Waratahs fly-half Bernard Foley started 2 penalties in the final 5 minutes to hand coach Michael Chisholm his first test win. Foley maintained a perfect kicking record on goal and was named man of the match. He says the whole team had to lift when it fell behind on the scoreboard.
The fourth score to Irish 99. That just goes to that position and first on 11 again, but they won't allow that at all. Because they're in the play, they're demolishing their system. Now the wind was coming up.
And in other rugby test match results, Italy came from behind to defeat Samoa 24-13. New Zealand beat England with a pretty second half display, winning 24-21. And France has ended a 4-match losing streak with victory over Fiji in 40-15. And in the English Premier League, Southampton has continued its first season form with a 2-0 home win over Leicester City this morning to maintain second spot on the table. They're 6 points behind Chelsea, which further strengthens its lofty position with a 2-1 win against Liverpool at Anfield. And elsewhere, Manchester United returned to winning ways with a 1-0 win against Crystal Palace. And to end this bulletin of ABC News, the main points. Asia-Pacific countries have agreed to cooperate on the extradition of corrupt officials. A 75-year-old Australian woman who was missing for 2 months in southern India has been found dead. And the recently discovered remains of some MH17 victims have arrived in the Netherlands. This is ABC News for Radio Australia.
Radio Australia. Recently, we've made changes to our program schedule. We've added new programs and some existing ones will now be made at any time.
We'll continue with our weekend sports coverage. And now on Saturday, rugby league on Sunday.
Programs in Prophet and Khmer will